Welcome back, friends. So let's continue with our discussion of Article 21. In the last part, we already discussed what is meant by life and personal liberty under Article 21. And in this part, I'm going to discuss with you what is meant by the term procedure established by law. Okay, so let's continue with it. So, the third term, see, let's go back to Article 21. The last part says that except according to procedure established by law. So, what is meant by this thing? Procedure established by law. You can deprive a particular person's life or his person or his or her personal liberty by a law which is established, which has followed a procedure established by law. So it is very, this is a very powerful weapon in the hands of the state. So it is very necessary to interpret and understand its broadness, to know like what is the widest amplitude of this power on the basis of which the state can deprive a particular person from his life and personal liberty. So for this reason, a few cases came up before the Supreme Court of India. What I am going to do, the two cases that I discussed for personal liberty thing, the cases were E.K. Gopalan and Menaka Gandhi. The same cases also discussed the issue of the meaning of the term procedure established by law. So in this, under heading 3, procedure established by law, now I am going to discuss the relevant part of those cases which interpreted this term. So in A.K. Gopalan versus State of Madras, a plea was taken that the terms procedure established by law in our constitution are in consonance with or are similar to the term that is used in American constitution, which is due process of law. What was being said essentially was that Indian procedure established by law is the same thing as due process of law. And as far as due process of law is concerned, under the American Constitution, because American Constitution is quite old, it has, the American Supreme Court has been interpreting this term due process of law. And in the present scenario, the term due process of law has attained very wide meaning, a very bright, broad connotation. So this was a plea. So what if we accept this argument that our procedure established by law is equal to due process of law, it essentially means that all those judgments of the US Supreme Court which have interpreted the meaning of due process of law will be implied in our constitutional provision under Article 21. So a very broad connotation will result because of this interpretation. But the Supreme Court in A.K. Gopalan case outrightly rejected this contention and held that if this was the intention of the Indian Constitution, that our procedure established by law or is equal to due process of law, why didn't they use that term which was there, as we have done with other articles? Because if we have adopted something from other constitution, we have used the same terminology so as to remove all the confusions around it. Why didn't they do with Article 21? So as a consequence, the term that was used was procedure established by law. And procedure, if we look at the term procedure established by law, it is very limited. What it says essentially is, what the literal interpretation of the words procedure established by law is, that the state has a right to deprive a particular person from his life or personal liberty as long as the state is doing it in accordance with the law, and that law is being created by following all the required procedures. That is the only thing, that if a particular state has followed the required procedures while adopting a law, the state can deprive a particular person of his life and personal liberty on the basis of that law. That is the only thing that is meant by the terms procedure established by law. So in AK Gopalan case, a very literal, a very limited interpretation was given to the words procedure established by law. It was said that it just means that the law which was created in pursuance of the procedure that is required, a normal way of adopting an act. And if that thing is satisfied, you are capable to deprive a person of his life also, a personal liberty also. So it gave the interpretation of the Supreme Court in AK Gopalan case gave a very big power in the hands of the state. So now what the state could have done? They could simply pass an act, and in pursuance of that act, they could deprive anyone of their life and personal liberty. That was the only requirement. I think on the first impression of this interpretation, you can say that this is not a law. This can't be accepted as a legal provision or a leave alone constitutional provision of a democratic country, because it provides outright power, absolute discretion into the hands of state. It puts people's life and their personal liberty at the peril of the state. Okay, so to remove such an interpretation of the provision procedure established by law, the second opportunity that came before the Supreme Court was Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India, 1978. Same case when the passport of Menaka Gandhi was impounded. Okay, so in that case, what happened was, in the case of Menaka Gandhi, the passport was impounded, but no reasons were given. No justifications were provided by the authority why her passport they impounded. And the only thing they said was that her passport is being impounded in the interest of general public. A broad statement was made. So Indira Gandhi challenged the impoundment of her passport. So what the Supreme Court said that during this whole scenario, the authority did not follow the procedure established by law in order to deprive Menaka Gandhi of her personal liberty to traveling abroad. The procedure established by law was not followed. So the authority said, the state said that no, we have followed the procedure established by law, because the Passport Act, Section 10, subsection 3, subclause C, only provides that, does not require you to provide any reason more than the in the interest of general public defense. So we have followed that procedure, and that is a valid law. We have adopted by following the required formalities in our Indian parliament. So how can you say that we have not followed procedure established by law? Then the Supreme Court interpreted this term in a very broad way. The Supreme Court said that it is not sufficient that you have just passed an act by following the parliamentary convention, and by that act only you can deprive a particular person, whatever be the nature of it, however arbitrary it may be. It doesn't mean that. Such a broad interpretation cannot be allowed in a democratic country. And the court said that the procedure that the particular act provides for depriving a particular person of his life or personal liberty has to be just, fair, and reasonable. It is not sufficient that a law provides a procedure for doing something, and it is if the state is following that procedure, or if a particular authority is that following that procedure, so it is sufficient to deprive a particular person of his life or liberty. No, the procedure that is being followed under the act to deprive a particular person of his life or personal liberty has to be just, fair, and reasonable. Okay, so all of these terms, just, fair, and reasonable, these are very subjective and broad concepts. These are very natural law terms. Okay, there is no clear cut definition of any of these terms. So by using such broad terminology, the Supreme Court greatly widened the basis on which the procedure of a particular act can be challenged before court of law. So it provided the public with vast power to challenge a law, the procedure of which they feel is not fair, just, and reasonable. One more thing the Supreme Court said in this case was, if in order to judge whether the state has a power to deprive a particular person of his life or personal liberty or not, the court has to see four things. The first thing that a court has to see is whether the law that is taking the life or personal liberty of a particular person is valid or not. If it is valid, well and good. Then we move forward to the next stage. The second question is whether the law which is valid is providing a procedure or not. If yes, good and well. We will move to the third stage. The third question will be, the valid law which is providing the procedure also, is that procedure just, fair, and reasonable? This is the most crucial stage. Whether that procedure which is being provided by a law is just, fair, and reasonable. And even if a law is just, fair, and reasonable, the last and the final question will be, does that procedure or that valid law violates Article 14 or Article 19? If that law violates Article 14 or Article, any of the rights provided under Article 19, it will be not a procedure established by law. So these third and fourth categories are more or less intertwined, because hardly there can be a procedure which is just, fair, and reasonable but violating Article 14 and 19. If it is just, fair, and reasonable, it will not be violating Article 14 and 19, or vice versa. So these two separate categories are provided just for clarity. More or less they fall under the same category, which in small words can be said as that the procedure has to be just, fair, and reasonable, and they should not violate Article 14 and 19 also. So what the Supreme Court did, it created a triangle of Article 21, 14, and 19. So the Supreme Court made a trilogy. It treated all of these rights as separate. What the Supreme Court said, that the rights provided under Article 21 are different from rights provided under Article 19. They are separate and independent of each other. Okay, you cannot say, or you cannot limit Article 21 in such a manner that it is limited to the rights that are already provided under Article 19. If that was the case, there was no need to provide, no need to create Article 21, because all those rights are already covered. Article 21 is a general right of life and personal liberty, which may include many things. And Article 19 is a specific right, which clearly specifies each and every right that citizens have. And in the case of Article 21, it provides right to life and personal liberty, which every person has, whether citizen or non-citizen. Okay, so both of these articles are different. So this was the holding of Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India. So if we see these four points, a valid law, procedure as providing procedure, fair, just, and reasonable, and does not violate it. So as far as A.K. Gopalan case was considered, so according to the judgment of A.K. Gopalan, if a particular law satisfies these two conditions, it was sufficient for the state to take life or personal liberty of a particular person. The only two requirements, that it's a valid law and it provides a procedure. Doesn't matter if it is reasonable or not. Doesn't matter if it violates Article 14 or 19 or not. It is a valid law providing procedure. That was sufficient for A.K. Gopalan. But for Menaka Gandhi, two additional conditions of just fair and reasonable and for Article 14 and 19 were added. Okay, so the next cases that we need to take care of will be discussed under this heading of other case laws, in which I will be discussing other relevant cases of Article 21. So let's look back and see what we have covered till now. So Article 21, three words, life, personal liberty, procedure established by law. We understood life, Munna versus Illinois, Francis Corellian, P. Rathina, Kian Kaur. We understood personal liberty, A.K. Gopalan, Menaka. And we understood procedure established by law, again A.K. Gopalan, Menaka. So other relevant case laws for Article 21, the first important case law is A.K. Roy, that is A.K. Gopalan. And this is A.K. Roy versus Union of India. This was a case of 1982. In this case, a very interesting point came into question. The question was that if there was a Section 10 of National Security Act of 1980, if a particular person was apprehended under National Security Act, that detainee did not have the right to cross-examine the witnesses against him. Okay, so if there are particular witnesses who are giving the evidences against a particular accused who is detained under this act, that accused did not have the right to cross-examine those witnesses. So we have this natural justice rule that no one should be condemned unheard. So a very important aspect of is that whenever a particular person is being accused, he should have the right to question the veracity of those accusations. It is so in such a way that right to cross-examine the witnesses against becomes a part of your natural justice, natural right. So in this act, by way of Section 10, this right to cross-examination was taken away from detainees under National Security Act. And the justification that the parliament provided or the state provided was that the people who are apprehended under National Security Act are very powerful and like hardened criminals. So first of all, it is very hard to find witnesses against such persons. And second of all, the witnesses are very fearful to come in front of that person and give evidence against him. They feel threatened. They may say, they may think that in future their life or their family's life and protection will be at peril. So they do not come forward. So that was the reason to ensure that the witnesses come forward to like provide evidences against that particular accused who is detained under NSA Act, that he should not have the right to cross-examine. So in Supreme Court, the parliament accepted this contention of the Supreme Court accepted this contention of the parliament and said that there was a reasonable reason for excluding this right to cross-examination. And this procedure is fit, is a reasonable, just, fair and reasonable according to the Menaka Gandhi judgment, and it does not violate Article 14 or 19, and hence it does not violate the personal liberty principle of Article 21 also. And the Supreme Court said that the natural justice rules that we just discussed are not rigid. They can be molded and they are quite flexible to suit particular situations. So in the case of these criminals who are apprehended under NSA cannot be put at par with the criminals under normal statute. So the distinction between the two, the treatment of two categories of accused was justified. And one more thing, the Supreme Court also took notice that under the NSA Act, the accused had a right to provide evidence in rebuttal. So if he had some objection or if he wanted to say that a particular witness is like whatever he is providing evidence are wrong or not true, so So he can provide evidence in L'Hopital. What he didn't have was the right to cross-examination, but he had the right to say himself that this is wrong or to provide documentary evidences in support of it. So more or less, his right of being heard was not completely excluded. Only a small fraction of it, that was right of cross-examination, was excluded, and that limitation was justified considering the background of the act. Next important case in this scenario would be National Legal Service Authority versus Union of India. This is a case of 2014. In this case, a PIL was filed by NLS, and the PIL was filed for the protection of the rights of transgender community. The question was that these transgender people are being treated differently and in a negative way in every day of their life, and this is very wrong on their part, or they are being discriminated for reasons of or in which they themselves have nothing to do. So for this reason, for these concerns, a PIL was filed. So while discussing this PIL, the Supreme Court came out with some interpreting. The Supreme Court got the opportunity to interpret some useful words. Supreme Court called these people transgender persons. They created a separate category. They said that transgender is a self-identified gender. What is meant by this word? Self-identified, that they may appear to be something. They may appear to be men or women, but if they think they are not that, or they are either of those on something else, a third identity, it's up to them. And as a state, as a country, it's our responsibility to provide them the right to choose the way they want to be associated or how they want to be identified in public. So the Supreme Court that said that Article 15 and 16 of our Indian Constitution prohibits discrimination on the basis of sex. And this prohibition of discrimination on the basis of sex includes self-identified genders also, which covers transgender persons. So the term sex, which was thought to be limited to either men or women, when we also read Article 15 and 16, what I said, that no one will be discriminated for the only reason that he is man or a woman. But that term sex also includes self-identified gender or transgender person. So what it now means is that no person shall be discriminated on the grounds of sex, which means that for the reason only of that he is a man or a woman or a transgender person. Okay. One more ground on the basis of which the Supreme Court agreed with the PIL was that Article 19(1)(a), which provides right to expression, right to thought and expression. The Supreme Court said that these transgender people, when they self-identify themselves however they want, they are exercising their right to expression. And it cannot be restricted on grounds other than provided under Article 19(2). And that restrictions that have to be posed has to be reasonable. Okay. And the Supreme Court also requested the state to grant a formal legal status to this community of third gender. So now we see whenever we fill a form of whatever nature, job applications, admission applications, we see there is a column, separate column for transgender people also, or a third gender also. So this was the case of NLSA versus Union of India. So as far as Article 21 is concerned, it is relevant as far as the provision of personal liberty is concerned. So this right of being, of self-identifying yourself with a third gender, not man or woman, is covered under the personal liberty concept of Article 21. The next important case that came up was Animal Welfare Board of India versus M. Nagaraj. In this case, the question of animal rights was an issue. In Tamil Nadu, there is a seasonal festival called Jallikattu, in which bulls are used as a sport. So, and there is an act also which regulates the holding of the whole event. The act, the name of the act is Tamil Nadu Regulation of Jallikattu Act. So under the act, the way how the event would be conducted, what are the things that need to be considered, everything is specified in the act. So this case was filed, and this Tamil Nadu Regulation of Jallikattu Act was challenged as violating Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act 1960 and Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. The petitioner, Animal Welfare Board of India, said that this Jallikattu festival violates or tortures, or there is a, the treatment that is meted out to these animals is very cruel, and they have to bear a loss of lot of pain for that reason. So it the whole events is the program of the arrangement of everything is in violation of the rights of animals, which are equally protected under Article 21 and Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act. And what the state that was taking the justification that Jallikattu is our traditional game and it is protected by our culture. So under our Indian Constitution only, every denomination or every community has been provided the right to preserve its culture, heritage. So by exercising, by holding these events, we are just doing that only. So, but when Supreme Court went into details and tried to know its history and when it was started and all, the Supreme Court found that the event or the game of Jallikattu had no cultural or historical significance. So the arguments, also the propositions of the state, were clearly thrown out. And the Supreme Court tried to give a broad interpretation to Article 21 and the concept of life and personal liberty. The court said that the right to life and personal liberty provided under Article 21 includes the providing of basic environment to all persons, which includes all forms of life, all forms of life, whether he or she is a human being or an animal or other creatures. So all have their basic right to a healthy environment. So human existence, it's not just about the human beings only. Human beings in themselves are all also rely on these creatures for their survival. There is a complete chain that goes on, and all and every particular species who is a part of this chain is reliant on the other. So it is very, very necessary to ensure the protection of the whole chain. So you can't limit Article 21 to only particular section of the particular part of it. So it was held that the protection provided under Article 21 protects all forms of life. So, which also protects animals. And it was also discussed that fundamental duties, Article 51(1)(g), also makes it a duty of all citizens to treat these animals with compassion, with love and affection. So by conducting such events, these people are violating their fundamental duty also. And under DPSP, the state have also been, it has been obliged, it has been made a duty of the state to ensure the required protection of animal and other living creatures. So the holistic view of constitution is that the rights of the animals also need the protection provided under Article 21. But the Supreme Court said that there is only one exception to this interpretation that we are giving to Article 21, and that is the exception of necessity. That in case of necessity, and that necessity has to be true, and that the Supreme Court will judge in future cases whether it is true or not. In case of necessity, the state may or may go and take the right of this right from the animal. So this is a very specific or very small exception of necessity was created to the rights of these animals to live in a healthy environment, which includes all forms of life. So the next important case for our purposes is, see, there's so many cases in Article 21. So far we discussed A.K. Roy versus Union of India, which was about National Security Act. The next case which we discussed was NLSA versus Union of India, which was about transgender people. The next case which we discussed was Animal Welfare Board of India, which was about prevention of cruelty to animals. Other important cases, if you want to go into details of them, you should have a look at them. Otherwise, the broad heading under which these cases fall, I have provided in the script. The first case is PUCL, People Union of Civil Liberties versus Union of India, case of 1997. Through in this case, the Supreme Court interpreted Article 21 and held that right to privacy is also a part of right to life and personal liberty. So the privacy concept was included into right to life and personal liberty. The next case, in the case of Olega Tellis versus Bombay Municipal Corporation of 1986, in this case, right to livelihood was held to be a part of Article 21, right to life and personal liberty. The next case is Mohini Jain versus the state of Karnataka. This is a case of 1992. In this case, right to education was held to be a part of Article 21 before coming into Article 21A. Now there is a separate article, Article 21A, which provides for right to education. But in 1992, it was held that Article 21 includes right to education. And the next case is M.C. Mehta versus Union of India. In this case, the Supreme Court held right to clean environment to be a part of right to life and personal liberty. So these are other four important cases. So this was our today's discussion on Article 21. So what we have understood, I hope that you have understood the meaning of the word life, personal liberty, and the procedure established by law. We discussed all the relevant cases. So this is in the next class that I'm going to take will be about Article 21A, right to education. In that case, we will be dealing with a very particular aspect of very particular fundamental right, which is limited to right to education of children who are of 6 to 14 years of age. But when right in the Mohini Jain case, when right to education was held to be a part of Article 21, it was had to it, it was there was no limitation as to age, and so right to education of all persons, whatever be their age, whatever be their background, was held to be a part of Article 21. So as far as other citizens or other persons are concerned who does not fall into the category of age of 6 to 14, their right to education is still protected under Article 21. And as far as 16 to 14 are concerned, they have a right under Article, their separate article, Article 21A. So in our next lecture, we will continue with the discussion of Article 21A. Until then, bye. See you soon.